Okay, so let me start first by showing you this thing. This is from Google Trends. It was a screenshot I took back in 2015. So Google Trends basically measures the frequency of a search of a particular word. What I did was I tried the word relativity between time of 2004 up until 2015, and I chose the category. And as you can realize, I don't know if I can actually move right there because of the... Okay, so as you can realize, no one is searching for the term up until to the end of 2014. Boom, there's a spike. Can anyone guess what's the source of the spike? Oh my God, you just burned the... Anyways, okay. So the word relativity is a theory by Einstein. There are basically two relativities, special relativity and general relativity. It's known to be revolution. They're basically revolutionary theories, but they're also very hard. Arthur Eddington, the guy who actually proved the theory, when asked in an interview whether, you know, is it true that only three people in the world understand relativity, his answer was, I don't know who's the third. So it's a pretty hard one to get. It's also, as I said, very revolutionary, so it changed a lot of the ideas we have about space, time, light, and gravity. So we always assumed that... is the video working? So we always assumed that, you know, the sun, because of its mass, pulls things, but it turns out it's just different. Basically, this net is what is called the space-time fabric, and the mass inside bends the space-time fabric, and therefore the planets get to revolve around, just like this way. So nothing actually pulls the other. So it's a very revolutionary idea, particularly that we always thought that the sun basically exerted some time of something like a spooky force that pulled the Earth towards it. But again, why would people, why would the Egyptians all of a sudden search for the term? What's my guess is basically it's interstellar. It's a movie. It's not a book. It's not a great lecture. It's not a class. It's basically a movie. A movie can inspire people to get to learn about these revolutionary theories and very hard ones. So, yeah, what is a possible explanation? It's interstellar. Yeah, and the source for that, because, you know, correlation does not imply causation. But, dude, trust me. I would assume interstellar is the reason. So now let's move to a much more interesting topic, at least to me, which is basically me. Not very narcissistic, but my interest in physics started back in high school. I watched this documentary for Brian Greene, which is basically based on the book, The Elegant Universe, that discussed an interesting theory called string theory. And string theory predicted that the universe we live in may actually have more dimensions than the one we know about. So our dimensions that we know is basically up, up and down, front and backward, right and left. These are three spatial dimensions, and the fourth dimension is basically time. So the theory predicted that we can be living in a universe, in cases like M-theory, for example, up to 26 dimensions. To a high school student, that was very interesting, because it seems it wasn't something I actually studied in school, and apparently it was a kind of knowledge that I had that my teachers did not have. So it was very interesting, and I was very inspired, and I wanted to study physics for the rest of my life. But it actually didn't stop here. I actually found another very interesting book called The Emperor of All Maladies for Siddhartha Mukherjee. He's a very interesting guy. He went to schools like Oxford, Columbia, Harvard Medical School, and he's also a very poetic writer. And his story about cancer and the history of treating and fighting this disease was very inspiring to me, that I decided I really want to pursue medicine. And then, in the summer, right before I get to university, I read another book called Poor Economics, which was also very entertaining because it dealt with poverty. It was for a MIT scientist called Esther Duflo. She's a brilliant economist. And it dealt with poverty in a very scientific way. It tried to find solutions, understand how people think. And I decided I want to be an economist. So Over the time, I started feeling that I cannot really be in some form of a monogamy with a particular subject. I was a little promiscuous. I loved a lot of subjects at the same time, and therefore I had to accept this fact about myself. I cannot really get married to one subject. I'd like to pursue them all. Now, my interest in these subjects happened to be at the time where YouTube was actually prospering. And this was an interesting place. I can share the information that I learned about. So I would learn about these things, and I would like to go to people and tell them, I learned about so-and-so, and YouTube was just the place I can do that. I started my YouTube channel in 2014, back in my junior year, and it started a very slow start. I expected, honestly, hundreds of thousands of views, but only there were 3 zeros missing from the number. So my first view was like 100 view. Honestly, I was disappointed. I thought I would do something revolutionary in the field. No one did a science show at the time. But again, I was the popular guy amongst my friends. And that's all what mattered. The growth continued up until I made this video that was basically explaining Interstellar. My voice is clear. Okay, yeah. That was basically explaining the science behind Interstellar. I read the books for Brian Greene. I knew about black holes, I knew about quantum mechanics, I knew about relativity, and the Egyptian public was very much interested in knowing what were the weird phenomena that happened in the movie. And so I thought I could do that. And actually, this video was viral. How many views did I get? Actually, 5,000 views. Which is not bad. I thought that was good. You know, coming up from the hundreds, I thought that was very interesting, particularly that actually a very famous football player shared the video, and I thought, okay. So it continued on a very slow curve up until 2016, where the channel reached up to 100,000 subscribers. That was really big time. Yeah, so I started joining a team and thinking, how can we make this show much more better? How can we integrate the techniques of drama, comedy, just like the ones we have seen in a movie like Interstellar, which actually inspired people to think about these subjects? And so we came up with some interesting ideas. One of them was the sketch that starts at the beginning. We thought comedy is a very good solution, particularly to Egyptians, because we like to laugh a lot. And so we had integrated to our team someone who has been writing sketches for comedy. And this is one of the videos we did.
ازيك يا عصام؟ ديلك الشغل اللي بتحبه. لا 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 ارجوك
ايه ده يا عصام؟
انا والله لسه ما خلصتش
ايه ده 5 دقايق ده بسيط كده ده حلو
5 دقايق ايه فاهم 5 دقايق ده ما خلصش في 5 دقايق معلش اديه لحد تاني معلش لا يا فندم انا تعبان والله العظيم ثلاثة
الف سلامة عليك يا عصام على بال ما اكلم الاسعاف خلص انت الشغل ده يا جماعة نادوا الاسعاف خلص
تعبان انا بجد والله انا تعبان
عصام بقى يا حسام احنا انت بتبوظ الاستراكشر بتاع الشركه احنا كلنا عاملين بريدج الناس تعدي من هنا لهنا عادي جدا انت بتيجي بتلخلخ الشركه خالص
انا قلت
ما ينفعش بص يا حسام بص ايه ده عصام انت تعبان
طب
اسعاف
على بال ما اسعافتي خالص ده يلا
كلها انت قول علينا ايه بس اسعاف اسعاف يا حسام عصام عصام
مات
خد يا مدحت انت خلص ده 5 دقايق بيخلص بسرعه ده ده بص 1 2 3 يلا 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 يلا
يلا يا النهارده
حلقتنا عن مدح الكسل
So this was one of the first techniques we used. We started thinking about comedy. We also did something, we also did another thing, which is basically think about the character. character. So we're not really going to use Ahmed to be the presenter of the show. We're going to make a character. We're going to design a character with points of strength, like, you know, basically, he's a little, or let's not call it points of strength, but basically things like being a narcissist. So he'd actually speak a lot about himself in the episodes. He'd be also very lonely. So most of the sketches, he's the same character because he cannot really find people he can identify with. And as you can see, of course, he has some naive dreams of being on a Time magazine back in the background. He's also very insecure, so he tries to show off the kind of knowledge he has. This character design has also helped us in building not only the set in which the episode is done, but also the comedy that comes out of the character. We also worked on something very, very important, and that's called the treatment of the episode. So this is one of our most popular episodes. It's basically about the effect of food on history. Now, we can make a very good video about how food affected our history, but we thought of maybe adding a twist, a little joke that people can relate to when watching the video. And what can be the joke other than the famous condition or the famous set in which a student studying and then tries to sneak into the kitchen and starts eating. But then a mother finds out that he's not studying and he's just eating and then argues with him. You're such a careless being. You just care for food. And then he stops like, yes. What's the problem with me being concerned with food? Actually, if humanity was not really concerned with food as much as I am, things would have been so much different. Actually, we wouldn't have built civilization because how did we build civilization? Because we made agriculture, which was a source of making our tummies in good conditions and safe there. We don't have to wait for, you know, a good hunt. We'd have the food right over there. This was one of the reasons we had agriculture. This was one of the reasons we have civilization. This was one of the reasons we have cities. Why, also, yeah, famous argument by mothers, like, you should really study so that you can travel abroad, go to Europe, go to the US. Well, how was the US found? I mean, Columbus was going to India to bring spices for the Europeans. So, again, food. So apparently food is very, very important to making world history. And so these pieces of information are not really used as a form of knowledge that we give out to the people, but are given instead through a child arguing with a mother. You can expect how the comments section was like. All people tagging their mothers and telling them, aha, that's why I eat while studying. And so, yeah, this is our set. We made over 130 episodes, counting to over 120 million on YouTube, but another 100 million on Facebook, totaling to over 220 million views for a science show. That's really big. Our team became a lot much bigger, so we actually started, instead of doing one episode a week, we're starting to do it 2 episodes a week on AJ Plus. Usually the videos we did were like 10 minutes or something, but then actually in January, we hit our 100th episode, and it was a 14-minute episode, and it has about 2 million views on YouTube. So I'd like to end it here, because this is what I find the experiment of the show, El-Dahiyah, brings to light. So I'd end with a quote by Michael Stevens, who is also a very famous science YouTuber. He used to say, I teach people in a way that by the time they know they're learning, it's already too late. You don't have to be really very direct with the message you present to people. As much as possible, one needs to be subtle. And that's what we basically work on. Thank you.